and to just reflect for a few moments. 50 years as a parish, that is the first thing for which we thank God this evening. We think of all those who have come here to receive the sacraments, to be married, baptized, and buried from here. But perhaps especially we think of those who have received the sacrament of reconciliation too. That journey that each one of us makes to return to the embrace of the Lord. Cardinal Heenan, as we heard, invited the Jesuit province to turn this chapel into a parish. And you can see in the front of the booklet a brief history of exchange of letters. And I'm very pleased that he did so, because in my short experience here, this parish is outstanding. It's certainly outstanding in my eyes for the way in which it is led and is so much a creative part of the wider diocese and the wider church. And I would like to thank this evening Father Andrew, those who work with him in the parish council, for the great cooperation on a whole number of things that they give to me and to their neighbouring parishes to be very much part of a vibrant Catholic presence here in the centre of London. Of course, 50 years ago on this night, when the first parish priest, as we heard, was inducted into the parish, Cardinal Heenan wasn't here to see it, because 50 years ago today, there was the solemn closing of the Second Vatican Council. Cardinal Heenan was in Rome for that event. I know, because I saw him. I was there too as a young seminarian. And I remember vividly the dramatic processions of mitre and bishops going from the bronze door in St. Peter's, processing across up the central staircase and into the Basilica of St. Peter's. 50 years ago, the Church promulgated two of the documents of the Second Vatican Council. Two of the very important, two of the last documents, obviously. One was on the renewal of our understanding and relationship with the Jewish faith. And the second was the document which became known as the Document on Religious Liberty, which was a great foundational document proclaiming the rights of individuals because of their God-given dignity, including the right to search for the truth with a sincere conscience, a right which had to be respected not only by states, but also by the Catholic Church and every other institution too. These were two remarkable documents, and over these 50 years, as we know from our life as a church, they have shaped a church that is sensitive and outward looking to our Jewish brothers and sisters and to the plurality of life and faith, which is so much a character of this city. So two anniversaries this evening coming together on this wonderful feast of the Immaculate Conception. And these readings which we've heard, they too span the breadth of our experiences, human beings and as a society. Thank you. Think of the first reading again, of that scene in the Garden of Eden as it is depicted for us in the book of Genesis. Can't we recognize ourselves there? Can't we just recognize those aspects of our own life when we so rapidly turn to blame somebody else? It wasn't me, it was him. I did it constantly as a child. It wasn't me, it was her. No, it wasn't me, it was the serpent. And all of us, individually and as a society, are experts at scapegoating others for the difficulties which we have so often created ourselves out of our selfishness, our sinfulness. So we heard the man named his wife Eve because she was the mother of all people. And I think in that sentence there's no more than a recognition that every single one of us shares a flawed nature, an original fault, which runs through us like a name in a stick of rock, that it is just how we are. And we struggle with that brokenness of our nature constantly. And then we had the second reading from St. Paul's letter to the Ephesians, which raised our horizons and spoke to us of all that is best within us. All of that instinct that we have for beauty as a doorway through which we glimpse the greatness of the human spirit. We glimpse the creativity that God has given us. And we even glimpse the fulfillment that St. Paul spells out, that we, with this gift of faith, are chosen. And we know that there is a fulfillment which awaits us, which will fulfill every last aspect of our spiritual greatness, which, along with our fault, is built into every one of us. And that's our drama. The drama caught between our failings and our brokenness, and the greatness of our vocation written into our nature. And the figure that stands at the center of this drama is none other than the figure presented to us in the Gospel of Mary, to whom the Word of God comes. And of course, the dramatic contrast is between the disobedience of Adam and Eve and the absolute obedience of Mary, who says, "Here I am, do with me whatever you will." The statue of the Immaculate Conception of Farm Street sums up so much of that drama and of those readings, depicting, as it does traditionally, Mary in her pose of humble openness to God, with a foot on the serpent, which has in its mouth the apple of the temptation. And when we look at that statue, we can see ourselves, we can see the drama of our life, and therefore we can look to her as mother, as the one who understands us through and through, and knowing that through her comes our salvation, the resolution through the grace of God of our history and of our personal dilemmas and dramas. Today, in Rome, the Holy Father has inaugurated this year of mercy, a jubilee year. And he's opened the door of mercy in the Basilica of St. Peter's. And I read that this evening, many different artistic images of mercy will be projected onto the facade of St. Peter's. For us, the local churches, our year of mercy begins on Sunday with the solemn opening of the doors of mercy in the cathedral and in a number of other churches across the diocese. And in this year of mercy, Pope Francis asks us to reflect again on our journey through life, which is so dependent on God's mercy towards us. Mercy is the love of God responding to our brokenness. Mercy is the shape that God's love takes when it sees the mess we're in, the mess we have made. The mercy of God invites us always to stand and start again, knowing that what we have done is not held against us, as long as we strive to align our lives, as Mary did, with his will. And Pope Francis is very fond of saying that Jesus is the face of the Father's mercy, because in him we see the extent, the lengths to which God will go with his own love, his own being, his own Son, to make sure that we never lose heart and can always return to him. In this year of mercy, I've suggested that we might pray regularly the Hail Holy Queen, that prayer, because its second phrase is Hail Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy. And that has two meanings. It is Mary who is merciful to us because she understands our human nature in its glory and in its brokenness. So she is the one to whom we can come, knowing that we will be understood. And she is Mother of Mercy also because she presents to us Jesus, the face of the Father's mercy, the doorway to the Father's mercy. And in that sense, we can pray wholeheartedly that prayer, which we might just say together now. Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy, hail our heart.